Okay. Check if there is someone waiting for us. For all of you that have access, please download the slides you find in WeBeep page. We uploaded 1 hour ago. They're called GIS and SDG, if I'm not wrong, because there are some links that we will need to use during the lecture. Perfect. So perfectly on time. And welcome to this seminar. To the one of you that doesn't know me, I am Daniel Oxoli. I'm a researcher at the Department of Civil Environmental Engineering here at Politecnico. Probably some of you already met in class for other courses. And with me, there is Julia Leonardi, which is a student assistant. We will discover what was her role in this work. Mm-hmm. And today we are speaking about GIS and SDGs. How many of you, of course you have heard about GIS because this is the core of geographic information system, but how many of you have heard or have experience in SDGs? Do you know what means the acronym? Sustainable Development Goals. Just her. That's bad. By the way, we are here for that. And specifically, you see in the slide this final workshop, because this work we are trying to demonstrate today was part of a little project to which Julia collaborate. And this project was exactly focused on try to discover and create, yes? It's in the lecture folder. They told me that it's in the lecture folder. I will try to ask if they can check. And doesn't matter. So for the first part, we don't need links, so you can just follow. And I was saying that this was a little project. So this is the final presentation of a little project that we developed during last year. And specifically, the project focused on the development of some training material to start learning the connection between geospatial data and geographic information system with the sustainable development goals. And we will exactly use and test the material, the complete material for the first time with you. So you will be also the tester of the output of this work. But before, we will start from the beginning to check what is the the topic, what we are speaking about. So the lecture outline of today is exactly connected to the introduction of what are sustainable development goals and the 2030 agenda. Which is the link, the connection between the geographic information and the sustainable development goals. We will see how we develop the material, the training material on the topic, and then we will test the material by doing some practical exercise specifically on QGIS, so on a software that you know how to use it. And let's start again to speaking about the beginning of this story. So the beginning is actually in 2000 of this sustainable development thinking, and it will then concretize in this 2030 agenda. The 2030 agenda, it's a document that was created by the United Nations, signed by the 193 member states of the United Nations. And in this document, there are outline some a plan to achieve a prosperity for all humanity. And it's a really big and rumorous goal, but the idea was then set up before in 2000, between 2000 and 2015, where all the member states, they tried to set up some goal. They were calling UN Millennium Development Goals at the time, and with the aim of eradicating extreme poverty and hunger all over the world and promote mainly access to education. These were the main pillars that were these SDGs started. And the agenda, of course, is public, so you can access, you can read. It's a really, let's say, high level goals that was a memorandum of understanding at that time between different states to work towards the sustainable development. Why we are discussing that in a course of engineering? All this country, any time we have a goal, we need some metric to measure the progress we are doing towards a specific goal. And the 2030 agenda defines different indicators that allow us to measure somehow the performance of each state, of each region, of each city towards some specific goal that is set up there. How many, and this reporting process is something that is done at state level, coordinated by the United Nations. So it's something that is ongoing, and it's something that we can contribute somehow with our skills as geographer, engineers, and so on. Specifically, the development goals, sustainable development goals are 17, which are really big themes for that are set up by the agenda. I don't know if you can read, but you might have seen sometimes these figures somewhere. And this is exactly the graph or the graphics that explain the main topic. So we start from no poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, and clean energy, economic growth and efficient work, decent work, sorry, industry, innovation, infrastructure, reduced inequality, sustainable cities, responsible consumption, climate action, life below water, life on land, peace, justice, and strong institution, and partnership for the goals. These are the titles on which, towards which all the country is trying to make some improvement. Of course, all different countries start with a different level in the different goals, but the idea is to at least improve the situation in all these specific topics. To measure this progress, that is progress in these 17 goals, the agenda pointed out 169 targets that can be computed through 231 unique indicators. So, in principle, to report on all those SDGs, each member state needs to compute 231 numbers that are connected, of course, in different way with these goals. And you might understand that this reporting, we will then enter in the more in details of some of the goals for this practice. You can understand that this was a really tough work, especially for statistical bureau of the member states, because they need to collect a lot of information starting from the GDP, from distribution of population, the statistics on work, statistics on gender equality, statistics on education. So it's something that some states have, some states does not. And all these indicators at the beginning were defined according to traditional statistical data. That was what at the time was generally available from the member states. However, you might understand by your own from some of these, most of these goals are connected to the place where they are measured. So somehow they are connected to geospatial information, not just pure statistical information, but also the geographical dimension of this data was really important. And so now, say, during time, this was recognized by United Nations that set up specific working groups to define which would be the geospatial contribution to the measurements of sustainable development goals. You want to know something or everything about the, this specific indicator, here is the link. You can find it at unstats.un.org. In the metadata section, there are many documents that define mathematically, let's say, each one of these indicators and also the data sources that should be used for computing it. This is, there are some statements that I picked directly from the document that were generated by one of these working groups that works on geospatial information inside UN, which is the UN GGIM, and which Professor Brovelli is part. And this was what emerged also at the beginning of these analyses connecting SDGs and geospatial. So the SDGs are highly dependent on geospatial information and also Earth observation as a primary data for relating people to their location and places. So basically, to measure where the progress is or is not being made. In the in this framework, some additional, of course, work it was developed by the UN GGIM, which recognized that geospatial information is crucial, is critical for reform about not just people and where they are, but also socio-economical and environmental decision-making requires such kind of information. So for a purpose that is a bit higher than just measuring the SDG. And those fields of decision-making are at the core of the sustainable development, because you need to always to consider not just the environment, not just the society, not just the economic, but all the three things together. That is more or less the chain that identify sustainability in our current present. And however, if this geospatial information is considered crucial, is not always available, or at least is not evenly available in all countries of the world, and sometimes it's really scarce, or sometimes really doesn't exist at all. And to start aligning all countries on the most important, to start pushing, or at least inspiring countries and institutions to start developing such data set, the UN GGIM defined the 14, what they call just global fundamental geospatial data themes. This tool set of data is considered as the minimum set of data that cannot be somehow extracted from other information. So it's primary set of data and is necessary to study and to represent spatially in the geographical space all the objects and themes that are important for the SDGs and in general for the economic, social, and environmental decision-making or benefits. And having not just having those data set, but having this data set at different scale would also benefit the analysis are not just national, but also subscale, the national, so regional and local, which sometimes is really important. So we have a possibility, having all these data set available, to measure consistently SDGs wherever in the world and at different scale as well. This is a path, it's not what exists, because those themes are available for Italy, for example. Not all are completely defined. And if you think about developing countries, the situation sometimes is even worse, sometimes it's better, it depends on the effort that the government put in that. But we have some capabilities nowadays to have access to some of these teams, at least at a global scale. And this is exactly the focus of our project. So how we can explore these emerging data sets that are globally available also in multiple times, because if we want to monitor an indicator, we need multi-temporal observation of a phenomena, of a variable, and try to understand how to access, how to identify those data, and how to use them inside a simple QGIS. So is this possible? Yes. The answer is yes. There are, of course, some critical points to be discussed or developed, but somehow we can do something in this direction. In this work, we focus today mainly on the land cover and land use, which is one of these fundamental geospatial themes. Do you know what is a land cover or land use map? In general, generally speaking, so it's written more or less here. So we can consider land cover or land use data set, whatever geospatial data set that represents both physical, biological, and also human-made land cover, so surface on Earth. And having the land cover represents more or less what you see on the skin of the Earth. It's something that is natural, something that is agriculture, something that is urban, and so on. Land use, it's a further step that describe instead of maps, or geographical data, describe instead how this surface is used and is more connected to ecosystem or human activity that are taking place on the Earth's surface. We have these data set at very different levels. Some of them, I don't know, you might have used some land use cover for Lombardy region in your exercise. I don't know, I'm not in your GIS practices. Those data sets can be vector, can be raster, can be many different type of data, but they describe what's happening on the Earth's surface through classes, through specific classification generally. And these, if we go to browse on the metadata of the SDGs, you find that land use, land cover information are often present in the recommended information that are necessary to compute the indicator to describe an SDG. In which one specifically? So I use the conditional statement here, but it's like this theme, these data are have a potential role in different SDGs and more or less in all of them. Okay. Because if you go back, you can relate everything on this simple graph. So no poverty, you should know where and how people live. Then on not zero hunger, you should know about agricultural production. I'm just making some simple example. Again, on services on health, you need to know where they are located. Again, for gender equality, an even distribution of a specific indicator can be useful to be studied spatially, and so on. Okay. In the practice, shape or the information that is included in the available global land cover dataset is not sufficient to compute alone those indicators, but often we need to mix this information with other traditional statistical data and so on. So in this work, we try to outline just some specific indicator that can be linearly computed using geospatial data. Of course, we will see that we can even extend it, and this is, of course, one of the long-term objectives of this project. This is the background on which we were moving. And for having the possibility of producing this material, we applied to a little project call of the ISPRS. You know what is ISPRS? It's the International Society for Photogrammetry and Remote Sensing. It's a really old established scientific society in which I and other colleagues and Professor Bravelli to our officer. And they promote periodically some capacity building or training activities. They are financing, of course, some activities of this kind. And we apply and we won the grant for developing this specific project that is called, as the title of our lecture, Capacity Building for GIS-based SDG Indicator Analysis using global high-resolution land cover datasets. So it's really specific and long, but this was the title. And which were the objective we tried to achieve inside the project? The first thing was try to assess the actual, the current availability of already existing training material, but also on the data that were available practically. We also focus on the use exclusively of open data, because this is really match with the idea of sustainable development. So each nation should share information to be able to compute consistently those indicators across the different country. And that's all those data must be, let me say, must be open, okay? And to deal with open data, it comes that it's better also to use tools that are open, like free and open source software, like QGIS in our case, because we can control not just the data sources, but also the algorithm and the tools we use for analyzing them, and without any kind of economical barrier, also other country and nation and so on can replicate what we propose in a really transparent way. So these are the two key elements of the system, so open data and open source software. We then describe some possible methodology in a shape of exercises to compute SDG, some SDG indicator, starting from this global high resolution land cover dataset. And also, this was the starting point for creating a kind of methodology on distributing also training material connected to this topic. In the these are the additional motivation, if I didn't provide you enough. The ISPRS itself was promoting the collaboration on geospatial information research and teaching and so on to support global sustainability. This was in the statement of one of the former conference that they did. In accordance to the motivation are written inside also the 2030 agenda, but also there is an interest in still in research for creating such global data set from Earth observation and fusing different kind of data is still sometimes for some aspect a research topic. And so we need also to find some references to understand which can be the most suitable data and how, which are the things that are missing. So this was another kind of analysis we did within the work. In the, what we discover, or what was our assumption mainly that we demonstrate, that is there are some global high resolution land cover maps that provides capability to investigate, practical capability to investigate the SDG indicator. And again, here it's a statement about why we decide to use open software and why we decide to create training activities, because we believe that it's your contribution as young scientists in the next year, it would be critical to achieve such goals, to measure such goals. And so it's time to start thinking towards global sustainability also in our practical computation and practical exercise. Here is the team. So the project team included different personalities. Some of them are STEAM professors, also from abroad, of course, universities, so the international team. And these are the former also affiliation to the different working groups of the ISPRS. And how we briefly, how we define, how we start defining the syllabus of our training material, or at least the need for training, we circulate a short survey to some of our contact, and also through the channel of ISPRS and the Yelp forum, that is a Yelp group of scientists of ISPRS, and many other places. We had more than 100 replies to this seminar, and the amount we were open, it's still open. So if you want to participate, you're welcome. But okay, we have a short survey because the time was strict. And what emerged from that our main audience was people that knows about GIS, because probably we're students or students of our university in our field. That has a little to medium experience with global geospatial dataset, as my UF, for example. Little to medium experience to sustainable development goals, and a very little experience on using global geospatial data sets to compute some sustainable development goals indicator. But there was still a good interest in the availability of open and online training material. That's why the most final output, it's a webbook. So we will have some training material on the web that is still there, permanent, on the same link that you can use and reuse, and we will use it today for a test. When we start instead researching about the connection between global high resolution land cover data and SDGs, we found the universe on the Google Scholar, and with a really exponential trend of availability of paper and materials in the last year. Because, as I told you, it's something that is emerging since 10 years, let's say. And we got that if you try to search there, you can reach about 65,000 resources that they are somehow connected to geospatial and SDGs in general, okay? There are training material. Yes, there is something, especially we focus only on free and open training material that is available online. There are some courses, not all of them are free, by the way, so you might check, but there are some courses connected to SDGs, not just to GIS and SDGs, but to SDGs in general. We had some experience in the past, it was not directly involved, but Professor Rovelli was in the use instead, or in the research connected to high resolution global land cover. And also in the team, there is some Chinese colleague that is involved in the Global Land 30, which is the most, the highest resolution of the global land cover data set that is available. We won't use them directly in this lab, but it's suggested and pointed on that. And there was still some work provided by ISPRS in this field, so the use of global land cover for SDGs. So this is the references. And we try to narrow a bit the application of global land cover to what actually can be computed inside GIS. So the global high resolution land cover from our research could be potentially used exclusively to compute, to measure indicator for the SDG 6, 13, 14, and 15. And it could be used to complement other like SDG 2, 9, 11, and 12. We provided in the book, we see some example for SDGs for some indicator of SDG for 15, 6, 9, and 11. Okay, just to have a showcase of the capability of that. Which are the data we should focus on? And again, we try to define some characteristics of the data that can be can bring the data to be labeled as fit for purpose for computing SDGs indicator. And from this reference, it's really well done. If you want to read it, it's a report. It is identified that fit for purpose high resolution global uncovered dataset should have a minimum spatial resolution of 1 kilometer. So we exclude some of the available dataset and a minimal temporal resolution. So the map should be produced at least once every 3-5 years, so that we have enough short time period to measure the progress of those SDGs. Then, depending on the SDGs, you can select part of the whole data set you have, but of course the thematic detail of the maps available is indicator specific. So you need to choose one of these maps according to a specific class of land cover you are interested in, and so on. The highest resolution data set, I told you, it's global 30 dataset that is available for 3 years from 2000 to 2020. The temporal resolution is not exactly what we defined, but the spatial resolution is really high and is produced by the National Geomatic Center of China. It includes 10 classes of land cover, of course, regional or local land cover data set have maybe hundreds of classes. At a global level, we don't have such detail, because otherwise that would be, it's difficult to have a classification of land cover land use that is valid globally with so many classes. So there are some 10 main classes that are typical you see for many of this product. There is another Chinese, I think, if I'm not wrong, data set. This is the final observation and monitoring global land cover. It is available again for 3 years and it's 30 meter again. And what we will use instead, it's a European data set for our example. Of course, you can try to replicate with different layer. That is the Copernicus global land cover. And it has a spatial resolution of 100 meters, so it's lighter than the global land cover. And it has, again, 10 classes, or land cover classes, and it provides also fraction. So it has also maps of abundances, let's say, of each class in each pixel. That can be also useful for distinguish in a pixel of 100 meters which is the mix of land cover that is present. And is produced every year since 2015. So we have many data. Then there is another initiative that is instead from the European Geospatial Agency, that is the ESA Climate Change Initiative. The Climate Change Initiative, it's an initiative of ESA, where data connected to that are critical for climate change are produced from Earth observation, satellite mainly. One of these data is land cover, that is considered as a fundamental data for climate analysis. And so they produce maps of land cover at the global scale that are available since 1992. So they reconstruct the land cover with a really long time series. And it has a spatial resolution of 300 meters and 22 classes. And the classification is compliant with some UN or FAO. I don't know the English for that. FAO, it's fine, you know it. It's the UN Commission for Food and Agriculture, okay? And they have some rules, the some general standards. So these data is compliant with that classification schema. And then we have other data. Some of them are not, you see, multi-class layers. So we have some data set that represent just a specific class of land cover. An important one, for example, is the global annual settlement. That is a land cover map describing the built-up area around the world. So it's useful, for example, to tracking urbanization, urban sprawl, and this kind of analysis. It is provided by European Commission. We will use some of the data sets that are provided here. And then there are also other more thematic land cover, high resolution land cover data that, for example, this one that is important for SDGs 6 about water, and that describe freshwater ecosystem characteristics, and so as specific classes for these ecosystem. As I told you, we don't have the capabilities of few indicators can be computed just with this kind of data, but it's often we need some complementary data, even something trivial like the boundary of the area we want to compute, in which we want to compute the indicator, like the national boundary, regional boundary. It's an additional data that was included in the fundamental geospatial teams, so we will need it. We identified this is quite up to date and complete, which is the World Bank data set about the boundaries, the national boundaries. We can use it, and it's open and so and everything. We have another very important layer, which is computed, it's maintained and computed by the University of Southampton, that is called the WorldPop. WorldPop is a time series of map describing population distribution globally. And you see there is every 1 year we have a resolution up to 100 meters, so it's quite high resolution. And the population, it's a variable that is many times required by the indicator of SDG. So we will see in our example. Also, we pointed out the necessity of having urban center database, so some layer that identify areas where it's urban or not urban, because also many indicators make this distinction to understand the differences between cities and rural areas and so on. So you should identify spatially where, what is an urban area and what is not. And this database, for example, use. And as you see, it's one of the layer that is available from the Global Human Settlement project of the European Commission. And another one that is really useful is OpenStreetMap. Do you know OpenStreetMap? You ever use it, downloaded data from OpenStreetMap? OpenStreetMap, for one of you that doesn't know it, it's a volunteer geographic information project. So that it's a map of the world that is developed and created by the user. So it's not a governmental map or whatever. It's user as you that register to some specific platform that allows you to map the world around you in many different ways. You might see something in your courses. And most importantly, more than mappers, you can be also user of those data. So those data are open. They represent multiple thematic details. It's a vector data. The other one are mainly raster, not all of them, but most of them. And in our case, in our example, we use OpenStreetMap to derive some road networks, which is important for specific SDGs, but you can extract from the restaurants to the land use directly in OpenStreetMap. So it's always a valuable data set. The quality of the data is a bit patchy around the world, so the world is not mapped with the same detail everywhere, but nowadays it's, I think, the most complete and extended geospatial, global geospatial dataset that is known and available. And it's also up to date every single second, okay? What about the training material? The training material is in this shape. It's, I don't know if you ever use Sphinx, which is a Python library that allows you to compile online documentation. You can write some Python and then you write some markdown text that you put together your project. And then you, there are some hosting services like Read the Docs, which is another open source project that allows you to compile your code and your documentation and having a URL to share with your audience. Most of the software documentation has this shape, you know? So it's the same system that is used, for example, for QGIS documentation. And the link is this one. You did you find the slide on the WIBIP at the end or still not?
No.
Okay, then I will make a break. I will try to call the guy to because I don't have access to the WIBIP of this course. And I will try to share. By the way, if later in these two links, one is for the notebook, and inside the notebook there are many other links. One is to the data set because we create some case studies inside the notebook, and we also provide some sample data for the case studies in order that if you don't have enough bands for downloading a huge data set, you have some sample there you can reuse. And about the tools, as I anticipated you before, we decide to use QGIS. Why QGIS? Because first is free and open source, so completely embrace the philosophy of the project. You have the full control on the algorithms you use for manipulating your data. And it's something that you, more you use GIS software, more you appreciate, not working black box algorithm that you don't know exactly what they do. You don't have license to pay, so you're not free to pay. You can download and install on whatever operative system, more or less. You have support in multiple languages. You have support for most of spatial data formats and standards, so any kind of data format can be almost open. Processing capability are really good for the platform. You can customize them if you need them through plugins or even Python scripting. It implements other popular software, open source GIS software and libraries that communicate with QGIS to extend even farther the capability, analyzing capability of your software. And also it was, for example, successfully tested to support specific SDG mapping requirements. And here is again the reference work from which we discovered that. After saying that, we don't need, so the training course is not taught for expert user, but also while working, we discovered that you need really few specific functions to compute many SDGs indicators. And this is a draft of the summary of the function that you should know to master the computation we need for SDGs indicator. And we start from the simple how to open a layer in QGIS and make some symbology, something really basic, how to make selection on our vector feature, how to manipulate the attribute table of our vector data, and how to make some geoprocessing of this data, geometrical processing of the vector shapes. Then we have, of course, a big part that is connected to raster data format, because this global ISPRS resolution dataset are generally provided in raster formats. And so what you need to do is open the raster, styling a raster in your software, clip it, and make some statistics, zonal or global statistic on the raster, and type some raster calculator equation to make specific computation. Nothing more. So having this toolkit, you are fine for following autonomously even the exercise. Then this is more or less everything I had to tell you about the project. And again, our idea is to engage as much as possible students and professionals in the use of geospatial technologies for this specific topic that touch more or less all the humanities. And another more connected to research, but also important step is to stimulate the production and the usage of global data sets, because those are really good assets for every one of us, independently if we come from a developing country or whatever. So they are really important and they are really accessible nowadays. So try to make this data set, this list of data sets, be known among different level of decision makers, students, professional, and so on, so that we can really explore the value of this data set in the real application. Promote, again, it's something that we do here in Politecnico a lot, here, especially in your course, the use of free and open source software. And also having this, we discovered during this work that is doable to teaching about sustainable development and GIS and vice versa because of this connection. So it's a good occasion to learn a couple of things together. And this is important. Some remarks. So this is a training material and you are the first tester of the final version. So please, if you find some error, typos, something that it's not clear, you can, you know how to open an issue on GitHub. If you click there, later when I give you, there is an issue panel, I'll show you. You think you can go, you see also on the webhook when you will open it. You can go here, there is an issue panel up here, and you can create an issue. Of course, if you are registered, an issue is just a ticket that say from the user, oh, looks in that file at that line, there is an error. In this section, there is an error. So then the developer can track all the problems and solve it in a really, let's say, organized way. And if you want to use this procedure and this dataset for some technical work, you should always, especially for local application, you should always somehow check the reliability of your numerical results against some ground truth data, and so on. So this is just for didactic purpose. If you want to replicate this work for your thesis and so on, to pick something from here, please, as you are using global data set that have accuracy that differ country by country, region by region, always try to assess with independent data set the numerical results you get from such data. What we see, what we define, it's a possible strategy or procedure to compute an indicator. It might exist another one that is better, that is worse, that is alternative. So if you have also some suggestion in this sense, you can suggest on the issue of GitHub. The question, also from home. If there are no questions, we can have a break now, 10 minutes break. I will try meanwhile to make available the slides so that you can open this link. Just what you need is this link. I will leave it open here, and open QGIS that you should have installed in your laptop. And then we will try to make some exercise together. Julia will be here also to assist for local problems. Okay? Okay, see you in 10 minutes. We can then start back, so on the webhook. And just a brief overview of the interface. Yeah, I think you are aware about that. But here is the section content. So if you click, you go on the section. You have here the edit on GitHub So you don't need to have the link to the repository, but you can just click here to go on the GitHub repository that is open as well. This is for a reporting issue, if you find some of them. Also to contact us if you have specific suggestion, or even to contribute to extend the book if you want. You can download this book in a PDF, for example, or HTML, so you can use it offline if you need, by clicking down there. And about the section of this book, you see it's structured as our first hour of explanation we have. So here is everything. It's really compressed theoretical part, of course, because it was not the purpose of the book. Then there is a section on the data with all the link and references for the official portal that provides those data. About the tools, there is just a brief overview of QGIS and on the functionalities, and then there are the case studies. This is the most consistent part of the web book. There are some text box here that are highlighted. So please, when you see one of these, read it. It's important. Note, warning. It's where we want to point out something that is important during the reading of the book. The book is open, so you can use for whatever purpose you want. It's a CC BY license. And it's enriched with some links, hyperlinks, I think. Yeah, we need to switch that on the, if you click, it's open a new window, because it's not that comfortable. By the way, the first part just summarizes what we discussed before. You have the, if you are curious on all the different aspects, you can simply check the references at the bottom, or click on the link and go on the online resource. And here it's, for example, the table of the data, which is quite interesting. It gives you an overview of the data, but then also the link, and he asks you, and he points you on the provider page. Some of these, most of these datasets require a login at least to download. And if you, not all of them, by the way. So, for example, the Copernicus Global Land 30 that we will use require a login. So you might need to log in. We will see in a while. And again, also for the other complementary layer, here is the QGIS introduction, how to download it, and the specific link to documentation for the functionality that we will use. We developed the book with QGIS 3.2, but everything should work also on a higher on the new long-term release, which is currently the 3.28, I think. And here is the case studies. The case studies are in kind of order of complexity. Those are complex computation, not complicated. What is the difference? Is that complicated, it means there is something difficult to understand. Complex is just, it's not complicated, but it's just a lot of things that you need to do to arrive at the result, but all these steps are easy, let's say, itself. You should follow exactly what you find in the notebook, so that we are sure that all of you can compute the indicator. You are not obliged to use, for example, the same nation that we use in our example. You can use your own home country, you can use another country as you wish. Just remember that if you want to compute an indicator for Brazil or for Macedonia, the time of computation is different, because the area of Brazil is bigger than, so if for this example here, if you don't want to follow to use our countries that we pointed out, you use a small country that it would be easier to not stack your computer. So let's start from the first and the simplest, in my opinion, indicator, that is the 15.1.1. Let's have a look on what is it. If you click here, you are sent directly on the metadata repository, where there is a search, the official United Nations metadata repository for SDGs, where you can search for different goals and targets. And this target 15.1 had two sub-indicators. One of them is the forest areas as a proportion of total land area. Let's have a look on how it is defined. And basically, this indicator measure simply the ratio between the area of a region covered by forest and on the area of the total, with respect to the area of the total region. So it's a percentage, and monitoring this percentage, you can, for example, assess if deforestation is ongoing on your territory or reforestation is ongoing, which is should be better. The procedure, so the data reference and also the formula is specified in these documents you find in the metadata. And there are also some advice on how to or which data set you should use to understand, to compute properly the indicator. There are also some guidelines for the quality assessment of the results and data availability for the different countries and many other things. So let's follow the exercise. First things, we need to define the area we want to work. To define the area we want to work, we said before, we can use, for example, the World Bank data catalog that provides world country vector layer polygons at a quite high resolution. And you can click on the World Bank. You do right click and open in a new window. So we will try to fix this in the future version of the webbook. So having hyperlink that open a new page on your browser. And there is this World Country Polygons very high definition. You see it's a 6 megabyte dataset. Just think before to start computing, try to work quite clean when you do those kind of computations. So for example, I created a folder on my desktop, we call it SDGs, SDG 15. I create two subfolder, one input, one output folder. In the input folder, I put the data I download directly, so the original data from the web. And in the output folder instead, I save the results of my computation. So at least you don't mix up, because this indicator, it requires not too much data set, but other indicator requires many data set. And then having a clean working space, it's always suggested. The same you can do here in QGIS by creating a group that is called input and another group that is called output, or as you wish. So the first things we need to upload in QGIS, it's what we downloaded from the World Bank dataset. It is a shapefile of world administrative country, administrative boundaries. And I will place this in the input. So here we are. The dataset is provided in geographic coordinates. Be careful that for some example here, we are using, for simplicity, WGS84 coordinate reference system, which is the GPS one, so the lat long one. Remember that is not projected coordinate reference system. That means that we are working in degrees, and that means that QGIS, when you want to compute areas, length, and so on, make some approximation on the metric references, and I would never be tired of repeating that. If you want to compute properly distances and areas, it's better you project the data in the, for example, UTM zone of your country and so on. But for this first experiment, it's fine to work in this coordinate reference system. So the you know how to add the layer. So here is the example on how to use the function of QGIS for opening a vector layer. Let's open this layer. And the first things we need to do is to select our country. In my case, in our case, we use Suriname. Suriname is a country of South America, and you can check from the attribute table of the word country, there should be a column that is called name, English name here, name underscore yen. And if you sort it and you look for S, if you don't know where is it on the map, of course, what happened here? This not no, no. Here it is. Is it Suriname? And or you can select on the map as is suggested by the webbook. Then right click on the layer and let's export this feature as Suriname. And I will place it in my output folder. Okay? Override this file. Good. And I put in my output and leave it there. So we can turn off the input. This is Suriname. Then we can, for example, try to start give a nice visualization, because this is simply our working area. And through right click and properties, we can select, for example, a style like this that define the perimeter of our work. Okay, then let's go ahead. We want to compute the proportional of forest area, which is this 15-1-1 indicator. We need a map that somehow describes the forest cover. And this is available in different land cover, high-resolution land cover dataset. One of them is the global land cover data from Copernicus that can be downloaded in tile, as you see here, from this website. For example, not just from here, but it can be downloaded from here. Let me know if you can access the service first, and if you can download the data. Alternatively, there is a link that is in the chat for a Zenodo library, a Zenodo folder. Zenodo is a place where you can download, you can upload your, and download also open data and open material. And as you see here, we publish the sample data set is used in the case study. You can download the single zip file for SDG 15.1.1. Could you download the maps? When you're done, just tell me so we can go on. It works. Hello. Okay, once you have downloaded the map, you need to simply open it in QGIS. Let me close something here that I cannot see anymore. Okay. You need it's a raster layer. So the same as we did for vector layer, we can add it to the map. Open a raster layer And let's open the input data, which has this name, original one. What about this layer? This is one of the layer that is available in the dataset, the Copernicus dataset, and it describes the in each pixel, these maps as a percentage, which is the forest cover, the tree cover percentage of each pixel. So you see, now we give some style to it. There are areas where there are no trees, where there are less trees, and area full of trees. White one here is forest area in this default visualization. And this is important because what we need to do is to process a bit these layer in the way that we can define where is forest and no forest to simplify a bit the computation. First things we do usually when we deal with this kind of work, we clip this global data set to the area of interest. So how to clip the data set, raster, extraction, clip raster by extent, and we clip the forest data using the, no, sorry, clip raster by mask, not by extent. And we clip the forest data using the Suriname polygon, Suriname, I don't know what's the correct English pronunciation. And we save the result, something like forest Suriname. So we can identify that the clipped map of the forest, or the regional forest cover data. We save it in the output folder. Yes. Okay, so you know what is a clip operation on raster, right? So simply we subset the raster on the boundary of our polygon. Could you? Okay, so these two layers are enough for computing the forest coverage, but we need to adjust a bit the raster one. Here is the explanation. So as I told you, inside the raster, inside the pixel value of this raster, there is a percentage. We need somehow to identify or to define the rule to define where is forest or not forest. So if 60% of pixel is covered by forest, we can say yes, it's forest. Otherwise, no. In our case, here is suggested to reclassify somehow this map to have one in the pixel, so value one in the pixel where the pixel has a percentage bigger than 50, and zero where the percentage of forest cover is lower than 50%. How we can do that? We can do it different way. The easiest and most stable one for doing such kind of reclassification of the raster, or at least these ones that are quite simple, is the raster calculator. The raster calculator, it's a tool that allows us to do pixel-wise computation of raster bands. We know it. And this is the expression we need to write. So this is the syntax of GDAL syntax of raster calculator that stay, it works something like this. Let's create a map that is a copy of the original map. But we want to multiply the pixel of this output map that is true in this condition, so where the pixel has a value less than 50, multiply by zero. So the result will be that this pixel will have zero value inside the final output, final map. And we have this plus, that means add another condition, that where pixel has a value bigger or equal than 50, we put 1, multiply that pixel by one. Those are Boolean statements that give you 0, 1, more or less. So when is one, it's fulfilled and you can multiply by 0. When is one is fulfilled, you can multiply by 1. Otherwise, the condition is not true and the raster is not changed. Let's try to compute these forest area mask with the raster calculator. We need to run an expression of this type. You can type, you can use the button here. Let's use the Suriname band 1, where we have just one band, that is the forest cover, that is minor than 50 by 0. This is just one of, actually it was Julia selected criteria. You can use a different one, okay? This is a majority criteria, let's say, where the majority of the pixel is covered by forest, let's classify as forest. And let's save this output, like is suggested here, we can call it forest Suriname reclass. Let me close. Okay, forest Suriname reclass. The place, don't touch the resolution, that it's or the spatial extent. And let's run the command. Okay. What we obtain is it should be a 0-1 map. Could you? Okay, just want to make just around to check if there are some problems.
If you need help with anything, I can come and assist. So just raise your hand or.
Let's check a bit the properties of this raster. You see, this is the resolution of the raster, which is in degree, of course, because we are working, as I told you, in geographic coordinates. But this is more or less 100 meter pixel. And we can change the symbology using a unit value classification. So we have just two classes in this raster, as we expected. 0 is no forest, we can put it in a color like no color. And 1 instead is forest. So we can assign a green color, for example. Here we are. So this is the area of Suriname that is covered by forest. We can check if we are doing correctly. Oh, this image is not that good, but yes, let's say I can see here it's no forest, while outside the mask is almost forest. You see here these big patches of forest that doesn't exist anymore. Okay, no, so now what we should do? Suggestion? Computation is quite easy. It's this one. Where is the final? So we need to compute the forest area and the total land area. Some idea on how to compute the forest area from a binary raster mask. So we have a map that is as inside a specific region because we clip it on Suriname, at zero somewhere and one where there is forest. If we count the pixel that are forest and we know the dimension of the pixel, we can multiply the count of the pixel because this pixel has value one. So we count all the value of the pixel. We sum all the value of the pixel, let's say, we found in the area. This number is the number of the pixel forest in the area. We know the resolution of the map. We multiply by the resolution and we obtain the area. For the polygon, we can use instead the area computation that is something available in QGIS from the attribute table processing. Let's see how to do that. Let's follow the instruction. So how we count the pixel inside an area? If we have a raster map and a polygon map, we can use the polygon map to bound our computation, and we can compute statistics of the raster value inside this polygon. The tool for doing that is called zonal statistics in general, but also in QGIS. And what you require is that you need to have an input layer where you want to compute the statistics, the raster layer to overlay and compute the statistics within. And then you can decide which kind of statistics you can compute. In this case, it's enough to us to have the sum of the value of the pixel that falls within the Suriname. And we can save these in a new vector file. And simply we will have in this new vector file a copy of the vector file we input, but with a new attribute that describes the statistics we compute. Let's do that. So you can find in the processing toolbox of QGIS, which is accessible from here, the zonal statistics, which is a core functionality of QGIS. You input the country polygon, then you input the reclassified map we created before with the raster calculator. You can decide a prefix on the column so you can recognize which column is computed in the output file through this prefix. And we can decide which kind of statistics we want to compute of the value of the raster inside the polygon. We want the sum of the value of the raster. And then we can save the result in a file that can be called country name stats. Okay. Let's save it and let's run it. Here we are. Let's explore the attribute table of the output. For simplicity, this polygon comes from the original Word file we have, we can, for example, remove all the attributes that we don't need. How to do so? We can click here on the pencil, so we open the layer in editing mode. Then here there is the delete field functionalities. We can don't remove the, if you use a GeoPackage, never remove the FID, because otherwise GeoPackage will crash. You can select all the fields that you don't need. And beside the field, just keep the sum we computed in the previous step. And then we press OK. So we clean up the layer and keep it just what we need. This sum, and then we can save it. This sum is exactly the sum of forest pixel we have inside the boundary of the country. Clear? And sorry, and now we need to work on the attribute table of this file that we obtained with Zona Statistics. And exactly what we want to do is let's compute in a new field the ratio between the area covered by forest and the area of the total area of the polygon. I know that it might be trivial for people that use GIS, but it's good to pass through all the steps. How we can compute a new field of this kind? Again, we can go here on the open field, on the field calculator. And first things we need to do is to give a name of the field that we want to create. So we can call it indicator or whatever you want, or 15, 1, 1. We need to be careful on initialize this field because in this case we want a percentage. So we might be interested in a decimal number, not just an integer, to keep some digits because it might be of interest. So let's format this output field in decimal. And then we need to write the expression for the area. So which can be the expression to compute the forest area? Well, is the sum field. You can find it also here in field and values. You can double click and it will be inserted in your expression. Then we need to multiply by the pixel dimension, that is 100 by 100 meter. So 100 by 100 meter. As is reported here. Then we need to divide this number by the area of the total polygon. We can compute the area using the geometry function of the field calculator. One of these is dollar areas. Let's use this one. And this will be our ratio, so a number between 0 and 1. If we want the percentage, we need to multiply by 100 again. Let me know if something is not clear. You have a preview of the results down there. You see that these are something that can be a percentage, okay? If you have some error, probably you forgot some brackets or you put something that was not correct. So let's compute our first SDG indicator by pressing OK. And here we are. So which is the value of indicator 15.11 for Suriname? 77.42. This indicator is a percentage. So 77.42% of area of Suriname is covered by forest. It was covered by forest in 2019, which is the year we selected for the land cover map. Clear? Could you? There are questions, errors, that rises. Give a feedback, please. Okay. Okay, you can check here. Yeah. It's probably with the raster calculator. From home, could you follow you have questions? No question? So we can have like 5 minutes break, so we solve the last issue and then we try to compute something more complex. Okay? Okay, so we hope that everything was clear. In any case, you have the full procedure there, the sample, the sample data, and so on. So you should be able to replicate for this country, for another country, whatever country. Let's jump to another case study that is in the webbook, and specifically at section 4.3, we decide to show this. Why? Because this includes also some vector processing, so we train also on some different data analysis. And this indicator is connected to SDG 9, the sustainable, which is industry innovation and infrastructure, sorry. And specifically, it's connected to road infrastructure. One of the index that is used is this RAI index, which is the rural access index, that measure mainly the population that has access, the rural population in general, that has access to roads, because roads are very important infrastructure to make people moving, okay, nothing strange. And this is encoded in the indicator 911. The indicator 911 is, as usual, specified in our metadata portal of UN. You have access to the documentation file that is standard for all of the indicator. These indicators we are using are well-defined indicators. There are some indicators that are still not conceptually fixed, but okay, of course, for this book, we select something that is really well-defined. And you see here, you have some indication on the data directly in the PDF of the metadata. There is this link to the WorkPop, global rural mapping. For example, we will use a different one, but it's just a decision, because it's more easy to retrieve and to use for our purposes. And then again, OpenStreetMap. And what we need to do here is first to download these three data sets that are the input, that will be our input. And then let's have an overview of the procedure. So the first things we want to do is to download the population map for Gabon, which is our case study, a country in Africa, okay? We download the population map of this country, and this population map, we see the characteristic in a while. Then we download from the urban center database, which is another package provided by Global Human Settlement Layers, where the urban center polygons are available. And then we download the OpenStreetMap road network, and then we will use part of it, try to discretize between secondary road or something that can be seasonal road. That's typical, for example, in Africa, to have some roads that can be accessed only during some specific season because of rains and so on. They might flood area, you cannot pass anymore from there, but then there are some roads that are instead available, or they can be route all the year. We will try to distinguish between that, and we will have our input layer. After that, what we need to do is we need to compute the area that is around 2 kilometers from those roads, because this is something that is written in the title of indicator. This area is 2 kilometer area, is the pertinence area from which we want to compute the population that stay inside this buffer, is called it, the proper name. We want to compute that amount of population, and we can do that with the same logic of vector raster statistics or zonal statistics. And we need to exclude from this area what is urban. So we will use also the urban mask, the urban polygon, to exclude those areas from our computation. And at the end, what we want to compute is the rural population. So the population that is not in the city center. So we need to remove this from the total population that is in our WorkPop raster, from the one that stays just in the city. Then we need to compute the total population. And then we need to do this ratio. So population that is rural and is within our 2 kilometer buffer of our road network, major road network, and the total population that is in the country. Again, this indicator, it's a percentage, as you see. So it's a ratio between two equal measure of two different, two measure with the same unit of measure, let's say. And the steps are more than the one for the forest area, because we need to find this rural population, we need to find the total population, we need to process the road network and so on. So let's start. Can you try to download the data? So one is this one, and we have the world population. There are multiple layers available from this data set, and we can use the one that is linked. There's no time to discuss all of them. You can explore on your own this data set, really valuable. We look for the Gabon, data, and we download it.
By the way, I think it's better if you just download from also Zenodo, because it's already the data that is going to be used in the exercise.
You can use also the sample data. If you want to use Gabon, there are the sample data on Zenodo. The link is in the chat or also in the webbook. And then the other data set we want to download is this urban center database. It's again a polygon data set. And there are different ways of downloading OpenStreetMap data. You can download these from GeoFabric, which is a service that allows us to download all the OpenStreetMap data set for a country, for example, for a continent and so on. You will download the whole data set, the whole database of OpenStreetMap in the country. And then you have multiple layers. So you need to keep just the one is written here if you use GeoFabric. So the GIS underscore OSM underscore roads underscore free underscore one. If you download the full zip package, you unzip and you find it, or you find directly on Zenodo. I will start to add those layers to my project with the same logic as before: input, output, and I have already downloaded to save a bit of time. So we have the population. You see here it's a raster map 1000 meter resolution. In every pixel, we have a value that is the number of people lives. Yeah. It's a result of a model. So cannot, there are other data sets that can be more precise, but this is available in a raster format. So we can adapt to any shape or study area that we want and is available for the whole globe. Let's put in the input. Then again, we need to look at the Gabon nation inside our inside the countries. This is a passage that we should do later, but you can do it also now because you know how to do that. So we can look for Gabon in our something that you already download and keep it there for later processing. Gabon, this is Gabon. We just export the selected feature. Here, and then we can remove so that you know where you are working at least. See, that is the population exactly in Gabon perimeter. Let's instead add the raw network. And when you download the OpenStreetMap, OpenStreetMap folder from GeoFabric, you have many, many layers. You can remove all the layer and just keep this one.
If you need help finding the data set, just let me know. I can help with that.
I can show you meanwhile how it works with GeoFabric. You have already the link that point on Gabon. And here is the zip file. Okay. So let's add this a vector layer. Of roads, you should see it on a map. Then the last layer we need to upload to have everything set up for processing is the one of the city, the urban center. The one of the urban center is at the link in the book. And it's not this one. It's again a shape file. No, it's a geopackage, sorry. And it's called a GHS stats, blah, 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 2019 layer. And you find it exactly at the link it was provided. What you see is that these are the urban centers in Gabon. You see that it's not really high resolution data set, but at least it gave us an idea of what is urban center and what is not. There might be more fine data for the urban center, but okay, as before, let's give some styling to our maps so we can visualize things better. Especially, this is our boundary, and it's enough to change the style to the Gabon polygon so you can see better all the background layer. first things we need to do, according to the book, is to extract from the whole road network we download from OpenStreetMap just the roads that we can consider primary or not seasonal. Again, this one is this procedure is a choice that we did. There might be something more tuned for your country. There might be also additional layer for doing so. This is just a strategy. So you see, this is the classification of the OpenStreetMap data. It's not OpenStreetMap data can only miss some information, some attribute like this. We cannot do anything more than go on OpenStreetMap and add it if we know that this road, for example, is a primary road. But we can use this schema that is quite clever and fast. So there are some small roads, small or low-level roads that are labeled with a code that is lower than, bigger than 5121. So this is a numeric code, simply in the definition of OpenStreetMap attributes. We can filter by considering just the first part of this table. How we can do that? Simply going in the road network data attribute table. Then we can select using an expression. We know that this code stays in the field code, and we want, as expressed by here, all the road that has a code lower than 5,120. If we select the feature, we can see, not very well because the layer is already, let's put like this. Okay, we can see that we are considering now, from now on, just those roads that we are kind of sure that are not seasonal roads. Once we have done this, we can save the result of the selection in a new file that we can call, for example, all season road, just to distinguish from the original one. So we save the selected feature in a layer, shapefile, a geopackage, whatever you want, that is called all season road. And we add it on the map. This is an output. This is an output. Could you? You should end up with something like this. Okay, so you have your Gabon, your country boundaries, you have a major raw network, you have in the background the population layer, like here, and you should have active also the urban center polygons. Then we want to compute this famous 2 kilometer buffer, 2 kilometers pertinent areas from the raw network. And we can do that using the buffer geoprocessing tools, which is available in the vector geoprocessing tools section of our QGIS. Just being careful again about the projection of this data. We are working again in geographic coordinates, WGS 84. So once we need to compute some metric distance as the one of the buffer, or we project the data in UTM, in the UTM zone of Gabon, or we try to convert the length, the metric length in the, some arc. Okay? And the proportion is explained here. You should be careful that this is true, say 1 degree is 111.1 kilometer, 111 kilometer at the equator. Of course, at North Pole, this is not true. So now we are working around the equator. We can assume that this conversion works. If you work in Italy, please project the data. If you work in Sweden, project the data, because otherwise the arc is shorter than the one is supposed to be, and the buffer will be smaller, okay? And vice versa if you work on the equator. Okay, so we can set up a distance buffer for Gabon just of 0.011 degrees, arc degrees, and we obtain something like this. Geoprocessing buffer, we can save the buffer in a new layer, call it 2 kilometer buffer roads, as suggested here. So we buffer the all season roads we created before by the clipping. 0.0. Yes, my computer is in Italian, so I need to use the comma. Or in your case, you might use the dots. You want to dissolve the results. So we are not interested to keep all the segment of the raw network, but we need just one single polygon that describes this 2 kilometer buffer. And we save the file in like 2 kilometer buffer road. We run it. Here is what we have. So this is the 2 kilometer distance from all the roads we identify as all season roads. Could you? I hope so. So now we want to extract just the rural population that lives or that stays at least within this buffer. So we want to exclude the urban areas from this buffer area. We can do that by combining the buffer we created in the previous step with the layer of the city centers. Okay? And how to do that? Through difference. Difference is another geospatial processing we can apply on two vector layer. And what we obtain if we subtract one polygon to another is the part that is not in common to the two polygons. So it's a difference. Okay. You need to set up this order in the panel, not the reverse, otherwise you won't obtain what we are looking for. Input layer is 2 kilometer layer, 2 kilometer buffer layer. The overlay layer is the layer of cities. And as this kind of operation requires your geometry to be properly set up, you can mute somehow some error that might prevent the difference to happen. And I'll show you how. So let's try to do this difference, vector, geoprocessing, difference. We, as we told, we want the 2 kilometer buffer is input layer and the GHS urban center as overlay layer. Let's go here in the advanced option and let's change the invalid feature filtering by saying we don't want to filter. So we want to keep everything came out from the processing, and we do the same for the overlay layer. I repeat, you go here and you change the invalid feature filtering, because if you try to do without that, you won't obtain a result. At least this happened to me this morning that I was trying to repeat the process. We can save the result in the in another vector layer, for example, rural buffer vector, as suggested by the book. Let's save it. Urban. I don't have it. It's rural buffer. I call it like this. This morning, but it's rural. It's exactly this one. Rural buffer vector. We can call it rural buffer vector to be consistent. Let's save it and let's run. You see that simply this buffer, it's this layer minus this layer, and we remove from the buffer all the area that intersect from the urban center. There are a few examples, like here. You see, we remove those areas that are supposed to be urban centers. Everywhere around the buffer area. Could you? It's quite important, otherwise we cannot go on. And it's also important to keep the name in mind of the layer you process, because it will be easy to change the wrong layer for the next steps. Okay, so let's wait a second, let everyone finish the processing. From home, you have some questions. Meanwhile, we are waiting the class. Feel free to ask, of course. Yeah. Can we go on? Okay, so now we need to compute those population numbers, so the number of people that lives in the different areas to make the ratio that is the indicator. Now we have this buffer layer that we clean up from the urban areas. So we can compute inside this layer the rural population within this 2 kilometer buffer. How we do that? Again, as before, we have a raster with some value that is exactly the count of people per each pixel. And from the WordPop layer, we want to compute the count of people within the buffer by using the zonal statistics in this way, as explained in figure here 4.313. And let's look for zonal statistic in our processing toolbox. We input, let's follow exactly here, the rural buffer vector as input layer, and as raster layer, the global population, the govern population, sorry. And this is the only raster we have in the project. What we want to compute is, we can compute, I don't know, we can leave the statistic as they are. So count, sum, mean, just to have some idea. But what we need at the end, it would be the sum of the population. So we can keep the sum of population of pixel value that are people inside this area. And we can save this layer. Let me see how it will save a zonal stats buffer. Zonal stats. Buffer. We can save the result in a new geopackage. And let's run it. So what we obtain is a copy of the rural buffer vector, but in the attribute table somewhere we have this sum. This sum is the population, the number of people that lives in the buffer we identify. We can just clean up some, as we did before, some attribute that we don't need. We can just keep the FID and the sum for simplicity. Okay, so now we have the first number we need in our ratio, the denominator we have in our ratio that define the percentage of which the indicator, that indicator requires. And let me close this. Then we need instead to compute the total population of Gabon because we are interested in the rural, the total population that doesn't live in the city, okay? So here we have, as before, the World Bank dataset of boundaries, polygon boundaries. We did it at the beginning. I don't know if you've done it, but we can extract the Gabon layer, the Gabon shapefile, by selecting it and then exporting in a new shapefile. We did it already, so I think you can repeat, and then you can change the symbology to have the mask. Now we want to define. We want to clip also the urban dataset on the Gabon, the urban center dataset on the Gabon boundary, because if you didn't recognize this GHA's urban center, it's a global one. So we want just to clip on the boundaries. How to do that? We can use the clip geoprocessing, which does exactly what is in his name. So we clip geometries of two polygons, for example. We input the center, city center layer. We use the Gabon shapefile as overlay layer, and we save the result in something called Gabon Urban Extend Polygons. Here we have the urban center, here we have the Gabon Urban Extend, let's call it polygons. You can save it in what is written here, they want, okay, GeoPackage is fine, just to keep the same formats. And let's run it. So simply now we limit the layer of urban center to the Gabon boundaries. We can now try to, if you check this layer we created, it contains multiple urban center. For simplicity, we can dissolve all these urban center in just one geometry, so that then it's easier to use it as a mask to compute the statistics on the raster. How we do that? We use the dissolve operation, and we dissolve all this layer of this small urban center in a new layer that we can call it with the same name, but we specify that this one is the dissolved one. If we do that and we run the algorithm, simply you can check that now the urban center is just one row in the attribute table, because we dissolve all the geometry in one to have a simple mask to use for our studies. Now we have basically the urban area of Gabon depicted in a single geometry. What we want to do now is to calculate the urban population of the Gabon. Why? Because then we need to compute the rural population of the Gabon. So we will do the computation of the urban population. We will know the total population of the country. We will do total population minus urban population, obtaining the rural population. It's tricky, but if you think it's logical, okay? So first we compute the urban population to compute the rural population. How we compute the urban population? Zonal statistics again. We use this dissolved layer as input layer, the word pop layer as raster layer. We need the sum also in this case, and we save the zonal statistics in urban zonal stats layer. Let's go. So vector, geoprocessing, no, sorry, zonal statistics, dissolve Gabon urban extend. The raster layer is only one we have in the project, so it's the Gabon population 2020. We keep just the sum, and we save these in urban zonal stats geopackage. Then we can go inside this layer and check that everything was correct. So we should have a sum field somewhere. which is here. Again, we can clean up a bit this attribute table with all the attributes that we don't need using the usual procedure, pencil and erase field. We eliminate all the fields except the sum. This might take a while because the attributes are really a lot. I'm simply removing all the information I don't need from the attribute table. It's not a necessary step, but it's just for having a more clean visualization of what we are doing. Okay. Now we have also we have the rural population, we have the urban population. What we miss is the total population. The total population can be computed directly from our raster data because it's already provided for the Gabon, so it's already clipped somehow. We downloaded the country data, not the global one. To compute this, the statistics on an entire raster, we can use the raster layer statistic instead, which is another tool from the processing toolbox of QGIS that simply provide a report where you have statistics, general summary statistic of the raster. So let's compute this total population using the raster layer statistics, you find it here. We input the usual population layer, and it's not necessary to save the statistic in a file. We can keep it as a temporary file because we will need just to copy and paste the sum statistics. So if we run it, this tool provides a kind of textual report. You find a link, it's an HTML report, so it's a simple HTML report. There, a panel will pop up when you run this command with a link that you can click and open the report you need. So you see here, there is a number, there are many statistics. One is the sum. This is the sum of population living in Gabon, according to the World Pop. Let's keep these HTML file open in your browser. And let's go on with the processing. What we need to do now is to go back on our zonal stats buffer layer we created before. What we want to do is let's add there the total population number as an attribute and the urban population. So we have the zonal stats buffer layer, correct? Yes. Here, what you see in the sum, if you remember, we computed the rural population. Okay, so we can rename this field, it would be better, but okay, just to keep in mind that this is the rural population. Let's add two new fields. One is the total pop. And it can be an integer number because number of people, it's an integer number, even if there are some decimals in the raster because they kind of come from the modeling part. Inside this field, we will copy and paste. So we will paste this value, okay? The sum of the total population of the Gabon. You see that the number is truncated at the unit because we set this field as an integer. Then we can create another field in the same layer that we call urban population. Urban pop, again as an integer number. And let's save it before losing things. Now we need to remember where we found the before the urban population. Okay, so we need to subtract the rural population from the total one. Correct? Okay. It was a bit tricky. And you do that through the calculator, the field calculator, or you do that manually?
I think it should be done for the manually because it's in two different layers.
Okay, so this can be improved.
No, because it's all in the index calculation, in the last index calculation. I did not create it. There is no field for the urban, for the rural, total rural. It's already in the last step here. So the total rural of the total rural population is calculated within the index.
Ah, okay, so you do in one step, okay. And, okay, so what you need to do simply is to run these, we need to define the urban population before. Okay. So the urban population stays in the urban zone of stats. So we computed before this number from the urban zonal stats. We can simply copy this number, just for simplicity, in the zonal stats buffer, so that we have the urban population there, okay? Or we can repeat the computation inside this polygon, but we have this number. So this is the rural, this is the total, this is the urban. And this is the population living in the buffer area. This is the total population, this is the urban population. Then the last step would be to compute the indicator as it is defined using a simple formula. So in this layer, the rural population living within a 2 kilometer buffer is what is under the sum. If you didn't change the name, was the result of the summary statistics. So let's create a new field that we call indicator 911. The first element of our indicator is the rural population inside the buffer, that in this case, according to our exercise, inside the zona stats buffer layer is the field sum. Then we need to compute the total rural population as the subtraction between the total population minus the urban population that we have inside our layer. So it's total population minus urban population. This is a percentage, you can see from the preview. Depending on the buffer and on the approximation, you might have different statistics, some percentage point because of the geometry we are using. If you project the data, you might have different geometry because of the buffer and intersection that we did, but you should have something like this. If we click, remember to this is a decimal number because we want percentages. We can even multiply by 100 if we need, just to be coherent as the other exercise. If we press OK, the indicator says that Here is 71, probably. I don't know.
Yeah,
probably.
I think it's because of the data. Because
yeah,
the data.
Also because OpenStreetMap data change. So we may have more streets. A solution can be, you can go also in the historical database of OpenStreetMap and download the OpenStreetMap dataset at a specific time so that it's consistent with the other layer. So a bit differences might be due to the data we used. With respect to the one we used during the preparation of the exercise. But you see that 72%, in this case of Gabon population, rural population, lives within 2 kilometer buffer from seasonal roads. What you need to do here is just to copy this urban population from the other layer we created in the previous step, inside this attribute table, which is easier than to pick in the formula. Otherwise, you need to type manually something. You can do whatever. You can do it with a calculator because you have all the elements. But here is how the indicator is defined. More complex. There are even more complex examples here if you want to test. It's just a matter of following the logics and all the steps in the correct order. Someone might have more complex solution to that. This is quite linear. So we make some mask, we compute specific count of population in specific areas. We use those counts that are simply numbers to compute a percentage. And here we are. Questions? Too complex? Too tired? I'm tired too. I teach for 3 hours. Yeah. But this is to show you that it is possible without no, let's say, bound to compute such indicators. And this is not well known by many also professional and so on, because the availability of this data is not that known, at least this is from my experience. So at least you should be practitioner of GIS in the future, you should know that those exist. Any year something change, any 6 months new layer comes, sometimes it is not more up to date. But if you look inside those repositories, the Copernicus repositories, the UN, World Bank, you will always have an overview of what is available, what is maintained, what you can use. Then you download, you explore what is in the data, and you make your judgment if it is a fit for purpose data for such kind of application. Of course, you can use those data also for some other scientific application. The word pop is really useful, for example, because generally the population data is provided by census level, so it's not disaggregated. So if you want to compute the population in an area that is not a municipality, a region, a province, you cannot do that from a polygon maps. So this is a simple example of how that can be used outside the SDGs in general. But we demonstrate that also SDGs can be computed everywhere in the world with just your computer and an internet connection. There are questions from home, from the class? Was interesting, at least. I told you it is complex, not complicated, but complex. So
I think it would be nice if you would also go through the webbook and just see if everything is logical and it follows well the flow of the computation. And if not, any suggestions are welcome on GitHub.
Exactly. So you can use the issue I just showed you last time. How to do? Okay, if we have issue, we are more, everything is more, okay, we have an issue already. Okay, And you go on the webbook page, on the main page, or the landing page of the webbook, and then you have this edit on GitHub. You go on issue. You need to register, of course, because an issue should be associated with your name, with your username at least, and you can try to describe any comments jump on your mind that, of course, can be useful for the user on the web. Okay, so we can stop here if there are no further questions, and thank you for attending.